Hello, everyone. I'm Schuko Ohtsu from CoSTEP, the Communication in Science and Technology Education and Research Program. CoSTEP holds a annual science cafe in Sapporo, our beautiful city of nearly 2 million people. This gives researchers of science and technology a chance to talk to citizens and learn about each other's plans for the future. Another issue for these informal meetings is that citizens may have pressing questions about a technology that at face value they cannot understand and accept. For example, what do you think of glasses that are said to be able to help read people's minds? Some people welcome these glasses as a way to help reduce crime in society. Others, however, may call for the glasses to be banned outright due to the potential invasion of privacy. An event took place on last December, where I organized a science cafe called The Intervention of Science and Technology in Life. The talk dealt with society's readiness to accept technologies that give parents the choice of an abortion if a serious birth defect is found during pregnancy. The science cafe was designed to start a nationwide discussion about prenatal diagnosis technology before its formal introduction to society. This type of event provides citizens with a chance to debate the merits and demerits of the science and technology and weigh its impact on society. With the assistance of my colleague, Associate Professor Tetsuya Ishii, who specializes in regenerative medicine, the discussion was attended by nearly 100 citizens and students. The participants shared their feelings such as, the more I get to know the fact, the harder it becomes to decide if testing fetuses for abnormal chromosomes should be accepted. And I can't decide the choice, but I will follow the society's try to understand its implications. The science cafe doesn't seek a conclusion, but offer an opportunity to citizens to know the fact. Because of high expectation from citizens, I'm planning to hold a series of discussions on this topic. A report from the science cafe is published in English, so we can share it with international readers who are interested in this issue of bioethics. We call such questions trans-science that can be asked scientifically, but that cannot be answered directly by science. An American physicist named Dr. Weinberg coined this expression. The trans-science involves bioethical issues such as prenatal diagnosis has wide area. These questions in trans science go beyond the scope of pure science and are becoming more common throughout the world. Other good examples of trans science are environmental concerns, issues related to energy resources, and food problems, as well as gender relations. These are issues that come with realizing a sustainable society. In Japan, on March 11, 2011, we experienced the Great East Japan earthquake. Ever since, people's confidence has been shaken considerably in various policies promoted through science and technology. These are energy policy, national land development, urban planning, and disaster prevention. Furthermore, we Japanese are starting to reconsider their pursuit of material and economic gain when trying to recover from natural disasters. To encourage this trend with the goal of building a better future, citizens were invited to participate in community decision-making based on scientific reasoning and knowledge. We, Hokkaido University, educated the community because it is essential that we increase the number of citizens who actively take part in discussions about science and society. While I mentioned the dangers of poorly presented science in terms of inefficient energy policies, medical science has done much to make our lives better. And because scientific activities are closely connected with human development, we emphasize the activities that show the benefit of science and as well as the fun side of learning. In these days, younger people lost an interest and the literacy in science. This fact is our concern. To address this, we have made various efforts targeting school children. For example, we held a class for children to make mobiles to alert them to the ecological balance. We had another workshop using clear and colorless paints that light up under black light. This October, we held a workshop using Russian matryoshka dolls so the children could learn about variety of nested structure phenomena found in the natural world and human society. In this way, we can show people both the technical and fun sides of learning about scientific innovation. We also try to provide the participants with the opportunity to use their hands and feet and spark and embody their ideas. Before I finish my talk, I'd like to tell you about a unique workshop that was held for researchers. The event was organized with the hope of finding a symbiosis in the community of researchers and young people, half of which were from Japan and the other half from many foreign countries. Their task was to share their values of concerns creatively by designing and wearing t-shirts and taking part in workshops. On the green central lawn of Hokkaido University, each of the 60 participants drew a picture to represent his or her research subject and used it to communicate their interests and fellow participants. During the activities, participants enjoyed beers under the big blue summer sky. The people who plan and implement the activities related to science are called science communicators. They are bridges between researchers, other science experts, and citizens. They design two-way communication to discuss the research and that offers solutions to social issues, and at the same time, convey to citizens their exciting life through science and technology. Hokkaido University launched CoSTEP in 2005. Since then, CoSTEP has produced over 550 graduates. However, there is still a need to cultivate more science spokespersons. They will enhance collaboration among citizens and researchers for a better future. Please join our team of science visionaries. We welcome you anytime. Thank you for your attention.